portion, I want to ask you, what would have happened if Jesus would have stopped? What would have happened if Jesus would have stopped? The text this morning out of Mark's gospel is one that garners a sense of familiarity because we find it repeated in Mark chapter 21, verses 1 through 11, Luke chapter 19, verses 28 through 38, and John chapter 12, verses 12 through 18. We normally hear it on what is called Palm Sunday. It is Palm Sunday that gives recognition to this scene, which is called the triumphant entry of Jesus as he goes from between Bethany and Bethpage, going from the Mount of Olives down to Jerusalem. It is the Mount of Olives where we find this scene that Jesus makes this entry because he gives his disciples instruction to go into the city and bring back a colt in order for him to mount it and to ride into the city. It is this place, Bethany and Bethpage, that is reminiscent of going from Orange and East Orange into Newark up Central Avenue in order to get a bunch of spectators to really see what's going on in order for them to understand and know the significance and the purpose of everything that's going on. It's in this scene that it has a sense of importance because it is from the Mount of Olives when you check in the book of Zechariah, the 9th chapter and the 14th chapter, where it says that on the day of the Lord would come down from the Mount of Olives with a processional, a royal procession in which they would recognize the sovereignty, the lordship of God in their lives, and they would gather around God, and God would restore them back to their prominence of the time in which in their history they were at their highest under the rule, the kingdom, and the lordship of David. It's in Bible study that we learn about David, this boy who God turned into a man and gave him the kingdom of Saul. It's David, one who the Bible says that Saul slew his thousands, yet David slew his 10,000s. It's David that they recognize as the great military genius, yet he also had the heart of a shepherd that the Bible says David had a heart after God, that David was compassionate, David was kind, David was generous, and they looked for someone to relieve their burdens and to take them from under the oppression of Rome. They were looking for a military king like David. And it's in the text that the Bible says Jesus had his disciples go and tell them, bring back a colt, one that nobody has ever ridden. According to in the book of Deuteronomy, they were always instructed that every animal that they use for the presence and the promise to represent God's divine nature was always to be an animal that had no blemish, no spot. Nobody had ever taken advantage of it. It was never abused. It was never rejected. It never carried any burden. Therefore, Jesus told them, go into the city and get me a colt that has never been ridden. It's ironic that the beast of burden never bore any burden. Yet the one who rides it bore all of our burdens. It's ironic that Jesus instructs them to go and take something that belongs to somebody else to bring to him. But he tells the disciples, if anybody asks you why you're taking it, tell them the Lord needs it. My brothers and my sisters, many times God has instructed us to possess things that belong to God in our lives, and all we've got to do is speak the word. All we've got to do if we recognize God's divinity and God's power in our lives is to speak the word that God gives us, that we are the head and we are not the tail. We are above and we are not beneath. We've got to speak God's word to claim the things that God has for us. Amen. And it's in this scene that Jesus comes down off of the mountain. And the people are all excited, the Bible says. They took their coats and they threw them down at Jesus' feet. They put some on the colt and they took the branches that they had gleaned in the fields. And they were in the streets and they were following this procession yelling, Hosanna, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest heaven. Hosanna means in Hebrew, save us or save us now. It is the people that are looking for a king that would save them from the power and the oppressive forces of a Roman government that would abuse executive orders and take away the rights and the privileges of the poor and the marginalized, those that were seeking restitution and renewal and revival. It was a Roman Empire that overtaxed the people and put heavy burdens on. It was the Roman Empire where they had a king who, instead of ruling, all he cared about was who was against them and who was not loyal. The Bible says that even Pilate was afraid of the king, the emperor, and he was afraid to lose his head. That's why, my brothers and my sisters, when we think about the lordship of Jesus, we don't have to fear any ruler. We don't have to fear any power. We don't have to fear any principality, because Jesus is Lord. The text says that the people were crying out, Hosanna, save us. Yeah. Now, the strange thing is, the text says the people said something, but Jesus never says a word. The text says the people were crying out, save us, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord, blessed is he who will reestablish or renew the dynasty of David. Now the thing is, Jesus could have stopped right there. How many of us, when we get the accolades and we get the praise, our heads get so big we can't even go another step? Jesus could have stopped right there and basked in the glory of the moment and had his heart and his mind feel good because they were praising him and they were magnifying him and they were lifting him up because he was worthy of it all. It was the people that were shouting Hosanna. And imagine if Jesus would have stopped at that moment and called the people together and said, go get your swords, go get your spears, go get your weapons, go get your rocks and go get your sticks, and we're going to march on Rome. But I'm so glad this morning that Jesus did not stop in order to build up military power. But Jesus continued on the journey because he realized there were some people that would be born 2,000 years later that would also cry out, Lord, save me. Jesus knew that there were sons and there were daughters that needed him to keep his appointed time with Calvary's cross. Jesus could not stop there, because had he stopped there, your soul and my soul would still be subject to the powers, the rulers, the principalities, death, hell, and the grave. But I'm so glad this morning that Jesus kept the primary appointment. Jesus did not get wrapped up in the accolades. Jesus did not get a big head around all that was going on. But Jesus had you on his mind. Jesus had me on his mind, and he pressed on to Calvary. That's why I'm glad this morning. Because if Jesus had stopped right then, hell would be our portion. If Jesus had stopped right there, even the people shouting Hosanna would still be in death and in sin. But because Jesus didn't stop right there, we've got life this morning. Because Jesus did not stop right there, we've got a sufficient grace that moves past all of our fears and all of our doubts. Because Jesus did not stop there, we've got a faith that if it's even the size of a mustard seed, we can say to the mountain like, get out of the way. I'm glad this morning, for if Jesus had stopped there, you and I would not be here today. But because Jesus kept on, he was wounded for you and for me. Because Jesus kept on, he was hung high for you and for me. But early on Sunday, Jesus had stopped, your sickness would never subside. If Jesus had stopped, that thing on your job that gets you aggravated would drive you crazy. If Jesus had stopped right then, your enemies would overtake you. But because Jesus kept on, we can fight every battle. Because greater is he that's in us than he that's in the world. Because Jesus didn't stop there. He calls us to go into the highways, go into the byways, and to tell others that he saves because he's Lord. I'm so glad this morning. I don't have to wonder whether Jesus has stopped right there. Because the Bible says he kept on. That he was hung high, stretched wide. They crucified him. But a centurion had to look and take a double check and say, surely this is the Son of God. But they took him and they put him into a tomb after they had to beg Pilate for his body. They laid him in it. Didn't expect much to happen. And we'll talk about it next week when they came, what they brought with them. But I'm glad this morning that even at the grave, Jesus didn't stop there. And when he got up, he brought all of us up with him. I'm so glad there's no grave that can hold Jesus. And if the grave cannot hold Jesus, the grave cannot hold you and me. Because some glad morning, when this life is over, testimony, I'm going to fly away. This is not my permanent destination, but I've got somewhere else I'm going. Tell somebody, I'm glad Jesus didn't stop there. Come on, put your hands together and bless the Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Let us stand up over the church. There might be somebody here this morning.